So I think of rapid daily tests in two camps. So you have the Nespresso camp, and these are going to be machines that you have to go out and buy, and you have to buy capsules that are proprietary to that instrument. And yeah, they could probably be connected to the web, and you know, but they're a big machine, and that is immediately going to limit its distribution and utility. But it will probably do the job and do a really good job, relatively speaking. But what I really want to see for these tests is not an espresso model. That's good if we can get them cheap, but I just don't believe we can get them cheap and distributed in the tens or hundreds of millions. I want the instant coffee version that every single person around the world can easily get, that there's no frills, they're not connected to the internet, there's no buttons, but it does the job. And the job in this case is to tell you if you're detected as positive. And so both of these things can exist today, but the FDA is really pushing for this model over here, the Nespresso model.
I love that coffee analogy, because the cheap coffee still has plenty of caffeine in it. It still does its job.
That's exactly right. And in fact, it probably has more caffeine a lot of times. And I do think that, you know, the frequency that you use it, you know, you could drink 18 cups of cheap instant coffee a day for relatively no price, and you'll end up getting more caffeine than you would if you drink one cup of Nespresso. This is a tool that's sitting in front of us right now that the government and the feds and everyone should be putting billions of dollars into ensuring that every person has these tests in their home and recognizing that this is a way forward. So the companies that could develop these tests right now won't, for regulatory reasons. And the companies that are saying, okay, we'll go by the regulatory book and try to do this, they don't have a test that is going to necessarily pass muster as a diagnostic test. And again, we don't want these as diagnostic tests. We really want them as public health interventions that can serve to practically, in a couple of weeks, rapidly transform epidemics and diminish them. Saying that these are not sensitive completely misses the point. The important thing to recognize is to really make sense of this, we have to think of the biology that underpins these infections and the biology of what happens with the virus when it grows inside of you. The virus starts at anywhere around, let's say, 10 viral particles per milliliter, per swab that somebody gets. It will start growing, and then by the time it gets to about 1,000 particles per swab, the PCR test, the really good sensitive PCR tests that are expensive and hard to get, they will start to detect the virus at around, let's say, 1,000. But the important thing is these rapid tests might not detect a signal until the virus gets to, say, 100,000. So for most people, they would think, oh, well, that's not good. I would rather the test that detects at 1,000 instead of 100,000. But actually, the important thing here is to know that most people, when they're transmitting this virus, their viral loads, by the time they're transmitting, are up at a million or a billion, or even for some people, a trillion.
And then it will sort of persist for weeks, potentially, or months even, in some people at very low RNA levels. So it's after people are well beyond their transmissible period that we're actually seeing the loss in sensitivity of these assays.
These rapid tests, they'll kind of be a filter to only be able to view people who are actually transmitting infections. And the good thing is that they'll tell you at the time that you take it whether you're transmitting, and that will allow you to make decisions that will tell you, okay, I don't want to go to school today. I don't want to go to work today. I don't want to go into this restaurant. And so it will start to very rapidly stop the transmission chains. So we don't have to go find everyone who has any virus signal in their nose at all. We just need to find the people who at this moment in time are at greatest risk for transmitting. And this is where I think frequency of testing becomes so much more important than the sensitivity. Because if somebody's taking a test every single day, the virus, by the time it passes 100,000, you'll detect it on that day. Mm-hmm. You don't have to, versus if you're just using a PCR test every 3 weeks, you know, that you're very likely to miss whole infections since most of them are asymptomatic. I think we have few opportunities in life to truly change the course of an epidemic that's killing potentially eventually millions of people on Earth and continuing to infect millions of people just in the United States here. And I think that there's an exciting groundswell of support, and I encourage people to get as involved as they can, because as much as you'd be supportive of helping to push vaccines through, if the government wasn't already pushing that very hard.
Yeah.
I think we should all be considering this with the same urgency that these things need to get pushed through as much as any vaccine. And it's just not as readily palatable by the politicians and everyone. And so I think the more support we can get, the better.